Hello there, everyone. This is John Hardy here this Wednesday, February 23rd, with another edition of the Video FX Update. Coming at you with my awful cold still intact, hopefully going away very soon. I apologize if I'm snuffling and possibly incoherent. We'll try to get through this nonetheless. Can't stay away from these markets. They're way too interesting right now. Today's title, the stagflation trade, and I'll get to why we're calling it that. Pretty readily apparent reasons if you look at the price of oil. Today's highlights, we had in the European session today, the Bank of England minutes voting 6-4. That's a three-way vote though, 6 in favor of the non-move on rates and non-move on asset purchase targets. Three voices dissenting now on the hawkish side looking for a rate increase, and the one holdout Posen still looking for an actual expansion of asset purchase target. So that was considered all in all somewhat sterling bullish, though the actual rate expectations only went up a couple of bips because they're already quite high in the high 80s for the year forward, looking for 3+ hikes already from the Bank of England. West Texas Intermediate, it touched 100 bucks. Right now it's trading, right now being almost an hour before the New York equity close. Right now it's backed off a couple of dollars, and this is seeing quite an enthusiastic bounce in risk, as we've got a very hyper-correlated market right now. Everyone's staring at the oil price, and it's become the dominant theme for the moment. From what we know, from what we understand anyway, half of Libyan production is offline. That's about 1% of global production offline due to the ongoing revolution, if you will, in that country. Interesting overnight, I mentioned this in my report, I don't think it got as much notice as it deserved. The Japanese trade balance was a deficit this time around. Part of that, obviously, on the increase in energy prices. Japan is so dependent on imported crude oil and other energy commodities, and they have had a very cold January, and this led to a very large expansion in imports. But on the export side, there was also a very large shortfall relative to expectations, very small growth. And I'm suspecting, I would like to anyway, consider the possibility that this is a proxy for Chinese demand. And if that's the case, then we really need to start paying attention to this. I think the data we're getting out of China is going to be a bit difficult to get honest data anyway on what's really going on. So we need to start using proxies, and this would be one of them. So we'll keep an eye on that. Something certainly to keep in mind as oil prices head higher. If Chinese demand is drying up, no sign of it. This is just a speculation here, but this is obviously going to be a possible big issue going forward as they tighten and try to get ahead of the curve on their overheating economy. The Fed's Hoenig, or however you say it, I want to use the German pronunciation, I'm sure that's not how it's used over here in the U.S., was out with what I would almost consider a campaign speech running to replace Mr. Bernanke. I almost wanted to shout bravo when I saw some of these headlines coming over the wires. He's saying, listen up everybody, the too big to fail firms, they pose a great risk to the economy. The Dodd-Frank Act will not improve outcomes, quote unquote. History is on my side, he says, as he predicts that the escalating series of crises with rising costs, basically the serial bubble theory of the Fed, serial bubble blowing, traced all the way back to basically the Greenspan era, and he's basically arguing in favor of or against the Bernanke put between the lines there. Large financial firms shouldn't expect bailouts in the future, etc., etc. We must break up the largest banks. This is good stuff. Unfortunately, he's not a voting member anymore, but in my mind, this speech puts him at the top of the list for replacing Bernanke one day. Of course, that day being way off since he was reappointed so recently to his four-year term. Plosser, more interestingly, we had Plosser out. Plosser is now a voting member. Can't remember which Fed he's president of, but he was had a couple of statements related to QE2 saying, listen, I take our ongoing QE2 review seriously, and you can't rule out that we end the program early. So this saw very little reaction in the markets, but I think it's an interesting statement nonetheless. And on the voting, among the voting members, Fisher is even more hawkish than Plosser, so that's an interesting one there. In the U.S., we had a poor U.S. five-year auction. This didn't get a lot of attention either, but even before oil backed off, we saw risk rebounding a bit. We did see the bonds backing off a bit on their rally. And one reason being, as we switch over to looking at the themes in this market, we have a stagflationary theme here, which of course is bad for risk, but also bad for bonds, and not so good for the dollar. The dollar's not going to thrive as long as we have a stagflationary theme. It hasn't done too bad. If we look at the day, basically more or less unchanged versus the Aussie and a couple other currencies. But the dollar not going to do well. I mean, after all, you have the Fed still doing QE2. Their credibility relative to other central banks in moving on rates to deal with the stagflationary environments is virtually non-existent. So that's one reason we saw the euro dollar testing to new highs today, although those highs didn't, well, they've come back a little bit. They more or less have held, but we did see some back off there. So as long as, again, as long as this remains a theme, the dollar not going to do well, and that's basically the stagflation theme replaces the risk on, risk off tendency of the dollar for now, unless we get a unified risk off type of scenario, which would be bad for oil as well. And as long as oil is going higher, that's not the scenario we're going to see. So that's one to keep in mind, I think. Another thing we're going to talk about in a moment, European yield curve flattening. We have this incredible ratcheting higher of rate expectations for the ECB, which keeps beating on the inflation drum. And this is, and at the same time, we've had bunds rallying quite a bit recently, so we're seeing a violent flattening in the curve there. This puts pressure on European growth, a very interesting thing to take note of, I think. Also, of course, with a stagflationary scenario with commodities heading higher, this is a pretty lousy situation for emerging markets, and they're underperforming. If we look ahead, we're living by the headlines at the moment. Oil is really dominating all the action. No surprise there. I think it'll continue to do so as long as we trade close to this $100 level on WTI, anything above 105 or so on the Brent. And these are really unpleasant markets because they can just go up and down on the latest headlines. Technical analysis becomes difficult, etc. Tomorrow, if we look at the upcoming economic calendar events, nothing terribly market-shaking, especially considering everything going on elsewhere. We have the weekly claims from the U.S., new home sales, and durable goods orders for probably January. Don't have my calendar right in front of me. And, of course, the big focus, the Irish election on Friday with Fine Gael closing in on the 40% support level. It looks like it will form a majority government with the Labour Party, the first time it's been in power in I don't know when, but a long time. And obviously the big focus on renegotiating the Irish bailout deal and when and how that takes place, and the fact that it's encouraged the idea of restructuring some of the bond debt and some haircuts there. So that's a very key issue going forward in coming months. All right, as I snuffle my way through this, again, apologies for that. Let's take a look at a couple of things, if I can find them here. We have, first of all, the German yield curve. I wanted to show you this, the 2-10. Look at this, all the way down from over 200 bips at the beginning of the year down to 160 recently, and a lot of that collapse taking place here. Really strong pressure as rate expectations have ratcheted higher very, very strongly lately, and at the same time, Bund's finding support on a safe haven bid. This is seeing a strong flattening. If we look at the U.S. version of this, we've seen a very modest flattening from near record levels. I can't remember if that was actually the record. It's very close to it anyway, almost 300 bips on the 210 spread, and it's really only come off 15 bips or so from those highs. So obviously, again, stagflationary environment, market expects some central banks to raise rates to counter the threat of these commodity price rises, and the Fed not countering as quickly or as much. In fact, we've had Fed expectations falling, while especially Bank of England and ECB rate expectations have exploded higher recently. So that's some of the reason, obviously, behind a much higher euro dollar than it was recently, and same being the case for cable. The one last chart I wanted to show you while I'm on the Bloomberg screen here is emerging market equities. And if we look there, we can see that obviously underperforming, vastly underperforming the major developed markets. We've been flat now since basically October of last year. This is somewhat taking on a head and shoulders formation, and this weakness, I think, on the rise in commodities and the risk that the emerging market trade derails from here due to, especially with this latest round of commodity price increases. And as I trip over my words, let's go to the charts here. Eurodollar tried to break higher here. It has held, but it's back a little bit from the highs. I'll get to some interest rate differentials in a moment to show you that that move is supported. Let's go to that now, in fact. This is something else, but to go straight to the interest rate differentials, if we start off with Eurodollar, we've seen the differentials as measured by the two-year swaps ratcheting higher towards the highs of the cycle. That's the swap spread there, around 120 basis points. And spot has followed it somewhat, so it seems fairly priced, right, if we take all other aspects out of the equation, which is always hard to do. And the cable, we see the expectations even higher now, the spread even higher now than it was at any previous point in the cycle. Cable has failed to actually break higher. Kiwi, if we look at the Kiwi versus the dollar, those spreads at a new record low. This is, of course, due to this awful situation with the Christchurch earthquake, and that's pressuring the Kiwi across the board. Aussie, one reason it can't seem to go anywhere is, as well, the interest rate spreads have gone absolutely nowhere either lately, so that's one reason that it's been able to stay range-bound for so long. One thing that bothers me about the current environment is if stagflation is bad for the dollar, it sure as heck ought to be bad for the yen as well. And you would see that reflected in the interest rate spreads on Europe versus Japan, which have just absolutely exploded lately. We got 170 bips here on the 2-year, and yet yen remains fairly range bound. This is a bit bothersome, but it is what it is, and we need to keep in mind that the market always tells the truth. But if we're supposed to have stagflation as a theme, then I have a hard time seeing the yen doing super well. If we see oil collapse and then global growth prospects collapse, and then the spreads would likely collapse as well, and that would justify a range bound yen, even lower yen. But that's not the case at the moment, and it is a bit of a thorn in our sides relative to our themes. If we look at our Saxo Bank carry trade model, here we've seen this quite impressive fall off lately. A lot of this due to something like a 4 standard deviation on our shorter index acceleration in the VIX. I mean, it was range bound, hardly anything happening for a time, and then it really exploded over the last couple of days, and this has dragged the whole index lower. We've also had some risk aversion in the form of emerging market bond spreads. We can see that manifest in some of the emerging market currencies, as well as I showed you earlier, the emerging market equity indices. But other indices of risk appetite have been less weak of late, including corporate credit, central bank forwards, FX volatility particularly. So that's why we're still possibly seeing a range-bound activity in the dollar. I think if all those factors were coming off harder, we'd see the dollar doing better. And again, the distraction with the stagflation theme is causing some reluctance. Finally, while we're over here, let's look at the pigs. And we're seeing, if we look at Eurodollar spot, the darker line trading back towards the highs of the recent range. And yet we're seeing kind of a slow grind in the wrong direction in terms of pigs risk as we head into this Irish election. So not being supported on that front. It is being supported, the move higher in Eurodollar, that is. It is being supported by the interest rate spread moves, but not so much by the pigs moves. And you would guess that if this accelerates again, we're going to have a hard time seeing Eurodollar breaking higher and staying there for any length of time. Once again, if those pigs head in the wrong direction. Okay, briefly on the chart. So we covered Eurodollar there. Cable poised at that recent high area. It's come off a bit today. For whatever reason, we're seeing Euro more popular than Sterling at the moment. Rate spreads don't suggest that should necessarily be the case, but it is the case. Swiss, much like yen, why should the Swiss be outperforming when when you have a situation where stagflation is the theme, that doesn't make much sense. So obviously no technical sign at all of a turnaround here, but I would wonder if this 55-day area might come into support in Euro-Swiss. Of course, the euro is also dependent on other things besides that, with the pig situation and Friday's key events, but still, a big question mark there for me. And same again with Euro-Yen, as we mentioned. Dollar-Yen, got a curious situation where we have the U.S. going the opposite direction of the other major currencies in terms of rate expectations over the last few days, and that helps to support this this recent sell-off. But again, the yen is not going to get major credibility in a stagflationary environment. Quickly wrapping this up, note the NASDAQ, I think, is important to note, and possibly more than the U.S. S&P as you take out the oil component here. And you can see how big a drop this has been. And possibly, I would suspect, look how we've taken back out the old highs there, which we didn't do in this past sell-off. We didn't really take out those old highs. Significant enough to be possibly be the beginning of at least a sideways market, barring any sort of miraculous recovery and drop in oil prices because suddenly the Middle East situation appears resolved, what have you. Dollar Canada looking as indecisive as always. Our basic theory that the downside catalyst wouldn't be there was correct, but neither is their upside catalyst. And the 55-day moving average now is in focus as much as parity. So the first hurdle there is to close above that 55-day, which is in the high 99s. Aussie dollar, again, no major shift on the interest rate spreads. Risk has been coming off, but we have the stagflationary theme, which prevents the dollar from getting a better bid. So this move higher turned out to disappoint those looking for follow-through. This move lower so far has not produced the key knockout blow. And I think the situation there remaining uncertain. On the emerging market front, we have another attempt by the dollar to rally against some emerging market currencies. I think it's interesting here, this base in dollar MEX, dollar ZAR as well, finding a bit of support today. But this 200-day moving average still intact there. And once again, the focus will be on oil prices in the coming days. One interesting thing, I'll send this out later on Twitter, I think I forgot to mention this, was a discussion of the U.S. Housing market. Let's not take too much away from these existing home sales, new home sales, etc. I'll send this out. It was a CNBC interview with a very clever guy that was actually part of one of the inventors of the, now I'm going to forget what it was, inventors of the securitization of U.S. mortgages. Ranieri was his name. I'll send that out later on Twitter. You can follow me on Twitter at John J. Hardy. Have a wonderful day out there. Thanks for hanging with me. And we'll be back tomorrow with another edition of the FX Video Update. Take care out there. Over and out.